Hi, New Beauty followers. Thank you for joining us today for another New Beauty Talks. I'm features editor Tatiana Bido, and today we're discussing post-procedure tips to get the best out of your procedure, your surgery, whether it's an eye surgery or a facial surgery, a nose or rhinoplasty. Today we're talking to New York facial plastic surgeon, Dr. Leanne Klausner, and she's gonna give us her best before and after procedure tips so that you can get the most out of your treatment. Let me have her join us, one moment. Here we go. And we know everyone is busy with all of their holiday plans, but 2022 is gonna be a big year, so we might as well get started talking about it. Hi, Dr. Klausner, how are
Hi.
You?
Hi. How are you?
Thank you for joining us. And this is a topic that is near and dear to your heart because it really does help make or break your results, right? How you treat yourself before and after the procedure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, we say it's a collaborative effort, you know, between the patient and the surgeon.
Right. I always hear the number one thing is to follow your doctor's orders.
Absolutely. I try to give patients those post-operative instructions from the start. So they have a lot of time to read and reread those instructions so that by the time they decide to have surgery, they are very familiar with what the post-operative course could look like.
So what are the procedures that are trending the most right now at your practice?
Well, there's a big interest in facelifts, mini facelifts. Big interest in eyelid surgery. People are watching themselves on Zoom and they're Yes. identifying something that might bother them that they see on Zoom. And so they're looking to correct those things, particularly if they have time to kind of hide from the camera
Right.
for a period of time. But this also makes some of the non-invasive or minimally invasive procedures possible because some of those offer some improvements, maybe not as significant as with surgery, but
right.
things that can improve their outlook and their overall look gradually with no downtime.
Perfect. And then let's just get right into it. I actually had a friend recently who had eye surgery and asked, it was before her surgery. She was like, what can I do? I can't do Botox right now. Can I do face masks? Can I do microcurrent? So what are some things you should stop doing before your facial surgery?
Well, the most important thing is to stop things that thin the blood, so things that could cause bleeding. And the most common ones are drugs like aspirin, Motrin, Advil. Tylenol's okay for pain, but the other medications can actually prevent the platelets from sticking together. And the face, including the eyes, are very, very vascular structures, and that allows them to heal really well, but at the same time would put you at significant risk for bleeding if you were on one of those substances. And
right.
in addition to that, though, there are things that we don't realize also thin the blood, like herbal supplements. I usually tell patients anything herbal that begins with a G, including ginseng, ginkgo biloba, green tea, ginger, garlic, if they're taking those in a pill form. Things like that can also thin the blood. Turmeric, which we love, but in the pre and post-operative course is a bad idea. So to stop those herbal supplements, have that conversation with your surgeon also to let them know what you are taking because vitamins are medications as well.
Right. And how early before your treatment should you stop? Oh, 2 weeks, a month?
2 weeks is the general rule of thumb. Yes.
Yeah. So that really has to do with bruising, swelling, things like that.
Well, the most important thing is it has to do with your body's ability to clot. So we cut,
right.
there's a little bleeding, but the bleeding has to stop. And it will be prolonged if you're on those medications, and that could put you at risk for complications.
That makes sense. I was only thinking of the superficial
part of it. Yes, you would bleed as well. Yes.
Yeah. That makes total
sense.
And then what about treatments? Can you still use, if I was having eye surgery or nose surgery or, refining my chin, should I still be doing retinol every night? Do I need to take a break?
I would take a break. Take a break for you can give about 4 or 5 days, that would be best. You know, with rhinoplasty, we place tape on the nose as part of the splint. And if the skin is very sensitive, it could react to the presence of the tape or be more reactive. So good idea to stop anything that is causing a little bit of controlled inflammation. Good idea to stop for a few days before.
And so no acids, no...
If you can stop them a couple of days before, yes. And then as soon as you get clearance from your doctor as to when you can return, then you'll just resume.
Okay, what about, you know, the stuff, the other stuff we love, like Botox or a microneedling treatment? Should you take a, you know, extended period in between all of that, knowing you're going to have surgery?
Well, you can either do it before, maybe about a month before, a couple of weeks before in terms of Botox, or you plan to do it immediately, maybe about a month or so after your procedure. Some procedures, surgical procedures, can be combined with some more minimally invasive procedures like microneedling. So you could, if you had were concerned about lines around the mouth, for example, or crepey skin under the eyes and you're having a mini lift, you might have that conversation with your surgeon and she or he might combine those procedures at the time of surgery. So they're not off the books, but just having the conversation and planning it is the way to go.
I would assume, go ahead.
No, occasionally if someone is mostly concerned with their excess neck skin and jowls, but I notice some opportunity to rejuvenate around their brows, maybe they're not surgical candidate for a brow lift, but just a little improvement, we might even do a non-invasive treatment a week before and then have the surgery. And then, you know, when they're healing from that, they're recovering from both.
Yeah, I was wondering if you sometimes have to wait for everything to sort of, you know, like if it's a neurotoxin, leave the system, because doesn't it sometimes raise your brows? Or if you have crow's feet, can you evaluate a patient still for an eye surgery if they've had, injectables?
You want to see how they are in their most natural state, absolutely. And you don't want to do a toxin right before surgery. So the best time then is usually after. But if you've had toxin a couple of months before, and, you know, the best opportunity is to not have it on board at all, so the surgeon can really see where you're at. But most of the time, you have a relationship with your surgeon for a while, and so we've seen that, and we sort of know where that is.
You can tell we love our neurotoxin.
Yes.
It's like the number one question. Okay, what about just, you know, facial devices like your Clarisonic, your microcurrent devices? Are all of those okay up until the day of surgery?
I would stop them a few days before. I wouldn't just want any trauma to the skin right before I operate. And I would ask the patient to just refrain from that until we're in the clearance. You might be more tender in the post-operative phase too. The skin's more sensitized and you don't want to cause trauma that may put you at risk for an infection. So I would put all that on hold, probably at least 2 weeks, maybe even a month, depending on what you're having done and where you're applying it.
This is really valuable information, and these are real questions that we get. So thank you for answering. So what should you do? What are some things you should start doing before your surgery? That's a good idea.
Oh, very important. Healthy diet. You know, if you lead just a well-balanced, healthy life, I'd stop alcohol, you know, for about at least a week, 2 weeks, if you can, depending on how much you drink. You don't want to, generally smoking any of any kind impairs healing. So you want to make sure that you make your surgeon aware of that, because depending on the procedure really will impact the potential for complications after surgery. So, we want you avoiding primary smoking, smoking yourself, and secondary smoke, being in the presence of others who smoke while you're healing.
And how important is it to follow the directions? Like, how important is aftercare? If I go to the gym, you know, right away and my doctor says don't, what are some things that can happen if you're not following directions?
Well, I mean, you put yourself at risk for greater swelling. You can put yourself at risk for infection, because maybe the little holes, you know, in the skin aren't sealed off. You go to the gym, you touch something, the bacteria get into your skin. And you put yourself at risk for potentially bleeding, depending on if you're bearing down and with heavy weights, you could pop a blood vessel and get a little collection of blood under the skin called a hematoma. I mean, most people aren't in a state, immediately after like a meeting for eyelid surgery to even want to, work out. So it's definitely a conversation we always have. And generally, I'd say a rule of thumb, and it's variable depending on what you do, but will be at least 2 weeks, and it, depending on the strenuousness of the activity, may be a little bit longer. But that said, we like patients to walk around when they're able. Initially, maybe they walking around with a little assistance, but walking around is good. Exchanging air, getting fresh air, and having a little bit of activity is really good. It helps to prevent blood clots that can occur when you're just in a sedentary state or when you're just not moving around at all. So I always tell patients, you're not an invalid after the surgery, but we want you to just take it easy. And with that, I think, we all lead these very busy lives. We have to give ourselves time to heal. It's just having that healthy attitude and giving yourself time, not feel guilty about relaxing and resting and allowing yourself to heal. I think all of that is just very, very positive. It's sort of like the self-love that we can give ourselves. It's probably the reason we're going in to fix the thing that bothers us in the first place. Let's allow ourselves to heal too.
Right. It's so hard to stop and just, do nothing. So, but it's so important. So how long should someone, if you're planning to have a facelift, a rhinoplasty, an eyelid lift, or even just like a lower facelift, how long should you expect to be out of commission, and when should you expect to be able to resume your lifestyle?
Okay, well, we want everyone to get back into their lives as quickly as possible, and there's a little bit of variation, but generally, if we're taking kind of all of those operations in all comers, by 10 days, they're usually back to work. I always say 7 business days, and if you can plan it so there are 2 weekends around that, by the end of that time period, most people are able to go back to work. Now, in a rhinoplasty patient, to you, you might look a little swollen, but the major bruising and swelling that occurred under the eyes as a result of breaking bones and things like that should be resolved by then. And the same with eyelid surgery. With eyelid surgery, we're removing sutures at like day 5 and day 7, but there's still a little bit of time that you could use in order to let some of that swelling resolve. And certainly by, day 10, you can cover those incisions with makeup.
Awesome. That seems like no time at all for such a major life-changing.
Usually it's quicker than people think. And,
best
case scenario, of course, is people say, wow, this was bothering me for such a long time, and it really wasn't that long to recover from it.
It's amazing. So many people now that we're on this side of the pandemic, so many people I know have recently undergone some type of procedure that I never would have thought of before. But I think that just goes to show like the Zoom boom and how popular things are. And it's so true. People have been waiting since they were 18 years old to get their nose job, or you know what I mean? So it's good to take a moment and heal.
Right.
Okay. So when can you travel?
And again, it's variable depending on what's done. We worry about heavy lifting that's involved with travel, pressure changes and things like that. But general rule of thumb for some types of face surgery is definitely 2 weeks. Could be longer depending on, for the nose, for example, what was done inside the nose that might put a patient at risk in the postoperative phase. But, usually it's about 2 weeks and sometimes a little bit longer depending on what's done specifically.
Okay, so what should everybody have in their recovery toolkit? What are some things that are must-haves, and like scar, do we all need scar gel, arnica? What are your recommendations?
Well, I think the first is, a healthy, positive attitude and not being in a hurry to heal. That's number one. Giving yourself that time to heal and to rest and recover. So that would be, I think, number one. Healthy diet, with good amount of protein and vitamins. but with refraining from things that might put you at risk of bleeding in the immediate postoperative period, which we mentioned before. You know, avoidance of smoking in the form of yourself or secondhand smoking. And then as the scars are healing, it's very important to get a sense of how you have healed in the past. So, and that's a conversation you have with your surgeon before you have surgery, but do you form thickened scars? Do your scars tend to become lighter than your natural skin color? You know, we can do things to intercede in the post-operative period to promote more favorable healing. And so, yes, those come in the form of some types of silicone and some topical ingredients that can suppress pigmentation in the earlier post-operative phase so that we don't lose our pigmentation later.
What do you typically recommend to your patients? Is there one, do you like the silicone sheets better than the gel?
You know, some of it is patient dependent and the location of the scar. So sometimes a sheet can work well in some areas and not well in others. But I tend to like topical silicone gel. And that's something that both the presence of the silicone and the act of gentle massaging of the scar can help the scar to soften. And then I always look to see patterns of healing in people in terms of color, because I don't want them to have a white scar if I can prevent that from happening. So I like to tell patients about that. If they tend to have white scars, even if they're in the form of scratches or something like that, I try to be alert to that so that at about a month I can put them on a topical hydroquinone so that they prevent that long-term loss of color.
Okay, and then what about...
sun avoidance would be another thing. You know,
that's
they do
what I was
need
just
going to
ask. Do we need the SPF? Like, how soon after surgery should you be protecting your skin from the outside elements or even like blue light?
Right. Well, you should, in terms of sunlight, definitely you're not going to go out and tan a couple of weeks after a facelift. We'd like you to just be cautious of that because those scars are very vulnerable to the sun and they can darken, and then long term you can lose that skin color as well. So SPF is just a good idea, and when to put it on would be somewhat dependent on the state of your skin. We don't want you putting that on so early that it causes a reaction, but usually a couple of weeks after, to just be mindful of that, to wear, you know, some protection and a hat maybe when you're in the sun, depending on where you live. That might be more significant than, you know, in the middle of winter in New York City. But yeah, those factors are important as well.
And then what about adjunct treatments? Anything that's going to boost your results? I always see these amazing before and afters where someone's had a facelift and a laser skin resurfacing treatment, and I can, you know, all of it together gives you that beautiful result. When can you start adding on after your procedure?
You know, it's somewhat of a decision between you and your doctor, depending on goals. Some of them can be done at the time of surgery, so that if there is a little downtime from a resurfacing procedure, it can be done at the same time as the lift in some areas so that you're healing together. But sometimes patients will elect to do some lighter treatments, you know, a few weeks after surgery, you know, with microneedling. Sometimes we'll add PRP, which, you know, has growth factor in it and can potentially aid in hastening healing or optimizing healing. And so, yes, good skin care, what you're putting in your body, what you're putting on your skin, all important in terms of enhancing surgical results.
And then what about skin care in general? Mm-hmm. When can you resume your routine? And what do you typically recommend to your patients? Do you have like something that you give them, like a serum, or do you say go back and use whatever you were using before?
Well, you know, some of that is patient dependent. You know, patients may have things that they swear by, things that they love, that are good for them, they get good results with. And so I like to work with patients on that. But if a patient doesn't have that and is seeking something to do, general rule of thumb is you, as you're aging, our exfoliation rate is slowing down. So we want to look for things that will enhance exfoliation so we get improvement of texture. We want to make sure we have good hydrators, usually a topical vitamin C that can help with the stimulation of collagen, and perhaps a retinol, depending on if a patient can tolerate that or not.
And then you said it's patient dependent, but most likely after the 10 days.
Yes, exactly. So yeah. We just don't want their skin to be, especially if they're using a product that might create a little controlled inflammation, we don't want them to start that back too soon and have them react to it in a greater than way than we'd like. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much. This has been so informative. And like we said in the beginning, follow your doctor's orders, right?
That's right. Thank you so much for having me, Tatiana.
Thank you. Have a wonderful day. And everyone, follow Dr. Klausner for more information on facial surgery post-recovery tips. Okay, thank you so much. Have a great one.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye.